seriously. And I voted in 39 elections, never missed an election. Woman ran me off the road, wouldn't let, I sat in a ditch for the last half hour. She wouldn't let me use her cell phone. That's what I'm angry about, not about sitting in the ditch.
I called your cell phone.
How much time do we have?
An hour.
Okay, I'm gonna talk a little fast. I got a lot to say, but I'm only gonna talk for 35 minutes or less because we've gotta talk together. And again, I wanna apologize for being late. And now that you have cell phones, you were there doing all kinds of things. You didn't even miss me.
This is where Mike will be here.
Okay, so my name is Ray Rickman. I love to tell people, I used to be Deputy Secretary of State of Rhode Island. But when I went to the British Museum, they thought I was Deputy Secretary of State of the United States of America.
Wow.
And I have a special card, good for 21 years, and I got another 8 years on it. So I want you to know. I was born into an apartheid society. Show me the hands of everyone here born before 1965. Okay, you were born into an apartheid society. Now, we reserve that word for South Africa and the like and Rhodesia, because in America, we're very happy people. We've never done anything wrong. And if we have done something wrong, it was a long time ago and I didn't do it. And that slavery and everything. In 1964, 85% of African Americans could not vote, could not serve on a jury. In 98% of cities and towns could not be a policeman. Are you listening? So 50, 60 years ago, you couldn't be a policeman. What was the function of police before 1965? To give black people and Mexicans and anybody else of color a damn hard time. Now this is America, all police are perfect. No, that is what they say. And in Ann Arbor, Michigan, it might be true. In Madison, it might be true. I mean, you know, everybody slips. But just imagine a police chief who started, and the very first thing he did as a 21-year-old is take Ray Rickman in the James Meredith March and take a club and beat me on both sides of my head and bloodied me. There I am on national television, beaten half to death by this cop. And the reason I'm beaten half to death, normally police bother you because you did something, right? Yeah, we did something. We're marching down the road and a big truck comes and runs us off, and I know all about ditches because I've just been sitting in one for a half hour, but runs us off the road into the ditch. That's where we have to go to keep being hit by the car. And then we are arrested for trespassing. And the man files a formal complaint, the farmer. Now, it was all set up. Did I tell you the policeman beat me half to death for, if he believed it, trespassing? But I wasn't trespassing. This is what police used to do. And then in the last 50 years, they're told to be fair, to treat people the same. Now, think about this for a second. This is an absurd concept that you have to tell police, don't beat black people up. It's an absurd concept in a democracy. And then when we have public spasms, Black Lives Matter, then police, instead of saying, that policeman did something bad, we hope it's not endemic. Instead, we're all perfect. And whatever he did was an accident. Yeah, shooting the 12-year-old kid was an accident. And then you are asked to take sides. There should be no sides. There should be, did that policeman overdo what he did? So I know things. And sometimes I say to my brother, I wish I knew less. I served on parole board for 2 years in Rhode Island. And in spite of being 60 years old, it was really the most shocking experience of my life. Are you listening? During my 2 years, we had 12 white folks for embezzlement, average $550,000. It's pretty high because we had an $11 million woman. Would you like to know what you get for embezzling $644,000 from an 84-year-old woman with cancer? How much time you get in jail for it? 6 months, home confinement. Now, just before she came in, we'd had a kid who stole, stupid kid, stole two bikes, one worth 501 and one worth 540 bucks. $500, all of a sudden it's a felony. So he's got $1,000 crime of stealing two bikes, and he has 3 to 6 years in prison. And the parole board, that morning, we voted 3-1, me, let him out. He'd served a year. You get to come before the parole board after 1/3 of your lowest term. So you heard what I said. He got 3 to 6. He'd served one, and they kept him. She had 6 months, $644,000 she stole. 6 months home confinement. Easy home confinement. Easy meaning you can go to the doctor, dentist. There are 11 things you can do. Do you know how many times you go to the dentist a month when you're on home confinement? Hey, dentist, can I come over there again? So they voted, let her out, 3-1, and kicked me off the parole board for voting no. You listening? I was told, this is a tough one. It's going to look bad if it gets in the paper. So we need a unanimous vote. I know you don't like to vote for rich people who embezzle, but can you just do it this time? I said, nope. I'm going to talk to the governor. Your term expires in a month. I need your vote. I said, you think the governor's going to kick me off because I didn't vote on this one? I want you to pay attention again, and then I'm going to bring up race with you. 6 months, home confinement for stealing all that money. She gets out after 2 months. The black kid, 7 minutes earlier, serving at least 2 years for $1,000. He's 17 years old. He's an idiot. She is a 59-year-old, high-class, connected lawyer. Father was a judge. Now, that's why they want her out, because she's connected. So all 12 people who are embezzlers are white, and they serve less time than you would for stealing a bicycle out there. Two bicycles, let's be honest. White privilege. Now, do we own up to that? Do we talk about that? No, there's no such thing. And then if you bring up white privilege, people start saying that does not apply to me. I was just telling you about a high-class, rich lawyer who you would think if anybody's going to get white privilege, she'd get it. How about I had 11 white people, 20 years old, 21 years old, 22 years old. That's why I'm telling you about this one, young people, driving drunk, killing people with their cars. How much time do you think you get for murdering somebody with your car? She keeps saying 20 years. they get one. And 1 year. A third of them get home confinement. Every single one of the 11 young people, I voted no. Now guess who they killed with their car? One killed an 80-year-old woman who couldn't move fast, and the rest of them killed their best friend in the world. That's who's sitting next to you drunk at 2 o'clock in the morning. Your childhood friend. That's who you killed. Do you know what happens to those two families? So I'm a liberal. I'm not big on jail. So let's all do the same time, all the time. White folks with lawyers and money should not serve 10% of what Latinos and blacks get. And I'm not lying, I'm not exaggerating, I'm writing a book. And case after case after case after case, I would tell you all of them. Now every once in a while, you see a black kid come in and he gets out. It was the lawyer. He had a fancy lawyer, former Speaker of the House of Rhode Island, who they paid $10,000 for a 20-minute hearing, and the parole board held their nose and let him out. And the mother, I like to call people dumb, the mother, she mortgages her house to find the money to get him out. He got 1 to 3, should have got 1, and she gets him out in 1. $10,000 to a prestigious white lawyer. And you can look at every time a black Latino got out of jail on parole and there was a prestigious white lawyer. They didn't get out. The lawyer got some help in making a lot of money. So here's, every time I go out, I go out 30 times a year. I told Henry Louis Gates the other day, I'm trying to catch up with him. He speaks about 40 times a year. And I'd like to make 10% of what he makes. But anyway, that's another story. So every time I go out, I say to people, I want you to look at white privilege. I want you to look at what's going on in this society. And when you see it, speak up and complain about it. Let me tell you one story about myself. I have 17 of these. When I was in Detroit as a kid, my nickname was the Civil Rights Kid. And I was. Because the American Civil Liberties Union and the NAACP would call my mother up. We've got a case. Is Ray available to be the chief legal, for me to complain in court? And so I have 17 of these, 10 of them as a kid. You ready for the first one? I'm only going to tell you one. We move into an all-white neighborhood, and my mother buys the house. Oops. I just told a lie. A Jewish friend of my father buys the house for us, because we can't buy the house for two reasons. One, nobody black could buy a house in that neighborhood. But two, my mother's a widow, and women can't get a loan or even buy a house. I love to tell women this. I love to just stare at white women and tell them this. That before Dr. King and Whitney Young and Roy Wilkinson and Rosa Parks, white women couldn't be lawyers, couldn't do this, couldn't do that, nothing. And in the great civil rights bill, Dirksen of Illinois, US Senator, halfway decent man, sticks women in there in order to kill it. Because the Republicans are going to vote for it, but they cannot be voting for women to have civil rights too. That's a bit much. And the wives of those male senators go to work on them, and boom, the bill passes. And white women get rights. Harvard Law School, 51% white this year. I'm sorry, 81% white this year, 51% female. Did you hear that? Would I have ever thought that when I was the age of half the people in this room? No, because the law school class at Harvard in 1965 is 1% female. And they're just going for giggles and kicks because they can't get a job. You get a law degree. People do that sometimes, by the way. You get a law degree because you ain't got nothing better to do and you got a little resources and your father's connected. Eleanor Roosevelt fixed it so that white women could work for Social Security Administration as lawyers. And there aren't a lot of other places for a woman to go. That's the civil rights bill. Put your memory cap on. I'm very direct. I never beat around the bush since I'm years old. I have only so much time to convince you. And every chance I get, I tell white women, every time black folks get in trouble, you should help because of what black leadership did for you in the apartheid, anti-feminist society. You should help. If I were a white woman, I would go this afternoon and write a check to the NAACP. If you're broke, $5. If you're not, $25. And sometime in the next 4 years, they may be helping you again. So we move in this house, and the day we move in, there are 100 Lithuanians. I never knew what a Lithuanian was. Estonians, Latvians, Poles, Germans, across the street yelling and screaming. And every hour, a cop comes by and yells at us, "Hurry up, get that stuff in the house before dark." And every half hour, a Roman Catholic priest comes by and tells them, "No violence." He stands in the street and talks to all 100 of them, "No violence. No violence this time." You ready? This is a fascinating little story. Here's the whole neighborhood offering to burn our house down. Here's the Roman Catholic priest making them behave, and the cop is mad with us for moving in the neighborhood. This is America. This is not a southern city. This is Detroit. This is the place, nation, in which I came of age. You know, everybody's worried about Trump. Well, anything Trump wants to do to me when I was a teenager and younger was done to me, done to all black people. So this would be round two. Now, the first one was 400 years, and we spent the last 50 years trying to undo the 400, and now people worried about, are we going to start again? 7 o'clock at night, across the street, with big cloth bags, I'd never seen big cloth bags before, a woman comes, and she can barely walk, and then she's got her little 7-year-old daughter behind her, and she's got little cloth bags, and they come and they knock on the door, Mrs. Ladowski, and they own the Polish bakery. And she became my mother's best friend in life. So let me give this little story some grades. 80% evil, racist, nasty, awful. 20% good. Progressive Jewish man, decent priest. This is a great country, because it bends towards freedom. Now, before I end that first of my childhood rough tales, let me tell you that 90% of those folks threatening to burn our house down came to Detroit after 1946, getting out of Europe. They were renters and triple deckers. We are respectable homeowners, and they're going to drive us out of the neighborhood. Think about that. Not in America, 15 years, and they're out proclaiming whiteness and white privilege and looking through us. I believe my mother was the coolest person ever born. Now, I know you think your mother was. I know you think that, but my mother was. And the reason is she did block clubs, she did clothing drives, she did everything you could imagine. She got Althea Gibson to come to town and give free tennis lessons to kids for a month in the summer of 1960. Althea Gibson lived in our house. That's my mother. My mother would go to Wayne State University and make the professors come and volunteer on Saturday morning and teach math in the church basement, 12, 14 miles. And within a year or two, everybody in that neighborhood realized they'd made a mistake. That's why I love America. We can learn. We can learn. Now, we're not at a learning moment now. They believe about 75% of all white folks who voted for Trump voted against their personal interest, voted against their own children, voted against their mother who has cancer, who needs Obamacare. because they're angry because those people are all on welfare and all getting subsidies and blah, blah, blah. It's the biggest lie you can imagine, because all those people getting subsidies are getting subsidies down here. Now remember, when you came home from the war and you were white, you went to the town clerk, the federal government was 10% of what it is now, and all government programs were controlled locally, and you know there was the post office and the FBI and not much else if you go back to 1945-6. And so when Mr. Roosevelt and then Mr. Truman wanted to do something, they did it through the town clerk in Alabama. And no blacks need apply, no VA loans, no homes, nothing. 99% of all government subsidies went to whites. Now the coolest thing in the world is for your father, let's let him go to 92, to die and give you his house that the government gave him. And you're only 55 years old, and it was in the right neighborhood. Whoa, $400,000-$600,000 gift from your father that came from the government that no black person has, even though they went to save the world in World War II. That creates some wealth and some standing. You pay all your bills, and you still have some left. Racism is vicious, nasty, and constant. And don't ever believe that on day whatever, everything became new, everything became equal. How can it be equal? You know, I can take you to the extremes of the Browns or the DeWolfs, who have hundreds of millions of dollars from slavery, from enslaving my ancestors. And most of my ancestors have two part-time jobs. No, I'm exaggerating. Two full-time jobs. I'm sorry. Now, by the way, the average American has 1.8 jobs, and the average black person has 2.1 jobs. So I always tell people, be careful about black people being lazy. It's an absurdity. When are they lazy? When they're sleeping in the car between jobs? This is a tough place, and it doesn't need to be tough. We could fix this society in a year or two or three or four. We really could. So, this is what my mother used to say. You ready? When you vote, vote your interest and for the needs of your children. So I'm an extreme environmentalist. I want to know where you stand on cleaning the rivers. I am crazy in terms of trying to help kids, 17 and down. Where do you stand on that? So I'm crazy about Hillary Clinton. For 40 years, she's been interested in early childhood education. That's her thing. And in the White House, she would have done something about that, and the community colleges and the colleges public in this country. Vote your interests. Be selfish. And don't dream up the evil thing that someone's doing to you that they're not doing to you 9 out of 10. They're not doing it. Providence, headline. Anybody see it? $244,000 a year firefighter. The biggest headline I've seen until this week with the gangs. You should see the headlines in the journal this week. But white firefighter, living in Lincoln, kids in good schools. Lincoln's a great town, third, fourth best place in Rhode Island to live. And he's there. And he's angry. And he's voting for Trump. His salary is $72,000. Did I tell you what he's making? $244,000 overtime. His coworkers are sick every Sunday, 52 Sundays out of the year. And he stands in for them. What is he angry about? Good schools, good house, and double, triple the pay of most people. And my government money. What is he angry about? Nothing. He's lying. He's angry about a black man being president of the United States because that's a white man's job. And he's angry about 10% of black folks doing well. Well, about 40% of white folks do well, very well. And we forget it. The father was a janitor someplace, trying to make $20,000 a year at the end of their career, and the son's making $240,000 as a firefighter, sleeping two-thirds of the time. Now, by the way, I like firefighters. It is absurd. But what are you angry about? So I tell people, and I this is my seventh talk of the year, I say, anybody white, we know nobody in this room who's white is angry. Do you have a cousin that's angry? And tell me what he's angry about. I have a journal, 100 white firefighters in Providence and 100 white police officers in Providence. I went up to from September till the election. You voting for Hillary? She's pro-union. You have a union. No, I'm angry. Good. And I pull out my notebook. What are you angry about? He's gonna fix it. He's gonna make America great again. Four or five slogans, that's all I get out of them. And then the one or two honest ones would say, he's gonna end all those government programs. You know, talking to a black man, they're talking about people of color. And then I say to them, about 60% of people on welfare are white. Did you know that? Now, the truth is, it's because white folks are such a large percentage of the population. About 8 or 9% of white folks get welfare, and about 30%, and I'm not talking about classic welfare, but 30% of Latinos and blacks get welfare. But the majority of people getting welfare are white. So if you're worried about the dollar and not the color, there are a lot of white folks who need to be kicked off welfare if you're angry about welfare. But we lie to ourselves all the time. And I don't know what it's about. I do know what it's about, and I don't know where the thinking comes from. I just don't know where it comes from. So, in spite of all my criticisms, this is a great country. It moves forward. It gets better. I tell people, I live in a house on Barnes Street, 5 blocks from Brown. And next door to me, someone lives who's worth $88 million. And I just, I look at her, I get a kick out of it. She's never had a job a day in her life. That's all inheritance. Sometimes when I'm not feeling good, I tell her name, but I'm in good mood this morning. So, but just think for a second. She's got $88 million. The man behind me is a heart surgeon. Must make $3-4 million a year. Now, I'm not begrudging any of it. In fact, I'm shocked that I live there. I'm just shocked. Remember, I told you we lived in a little house on Garland Street in Detroit. Father had to go to heaven for us to have any money to buy it. So America's been very good to me and very bad. And it's been worse to most black and Latino, Asian, and Native American people than it has to me. I've been lucky. I've got around the barriers. And I've had friends. So let me stop talking at this point. If anybody has an angry relative or friend or next door neighbor, I'd love to dialogue about it, because that's why we are in trouble. And I believe 99% of those beliefs are garbage, unadulterated garbage. And they never met my mother, who says, vote your family. Vote your family. Do not be voting because you want to have a beer with George Bush. I think you want the public schools to be quality for your children and your grandchildren. That ought to come way above having a beer with someone you're never going to have a beer with. And if you do, you pay $1,000 and there are 2,000 people in the room and you're going to get 37 seconds with it. Wouldn't it be better to have quality schools than to be feeling good about the idea? Now, last word, this is a complex society. There's court system. In the Betsy DeVos got by to be Secretary of Education. She got 50 votes. Two Republicans voted against her. In Alaska, it was so rational. They don't have charter schools. They don't have private schools. And the senator from Alaska said, all I have is public schools and you want to destroy them. I can't vote for you. And in Maine, I think she said, I'm up for election in 2 years and I always get 51% and you're the worst candidate and I'm not voting for you. There were four or five other Republicans, we know their names, and they had to put the pressure on them because they were going to vote the interest of their constituents and not the interest of Mr. Trump. So we have real opportunity, and every place I go, I tell people, adopt yourself one or two senators. You don't need to adopt any Massachusetts senators, they're just fine. And Rhode Island senators are just fine, Connecticut's just fine. You need to adopt the senator from Maine and communicate. Every time an issue comes up. For the next 4 years. So I could talk all day, but time's up. What do you want to talk about? Now you're leaving. What do you want to say before you go?
I'm going to talk, and I have an 11 o'clock class with my intercultural communication class.
Wow.
So I'm so pleased this is on tape. So please keep speaking, please. And I'm going to bring the tape to my class next week.
Okay. And you're going to be on it. But you didn't say something on your way out the door.
I would just say that I am totally a product of white privilege. I recognize my good fortune. And sometimes I hesitate to speak knowing that everything I says comes out very slanted and like non-thinking. And I've devoted my whole life to being more compassionate and to really try to understand. It makes me want to cry. Because people don't get it, how lucky they've been. Because they just take it as their norm. And to really be in someone else's shoes takes a lot of time and patience. And then they get bored by that. And they say, well, that's not me. You know, it's like looking at someone from a third world country who's starving. Can you understand that? Well, there are people right next to you that are starving. And it's just maybe a different food they need. And then I think about you in the ditch. And no one would give you the cell phone.
Well, it was just one person.
But that's okay.
We're not blaming all 345 million people for that.
We're not all responsible for that ditch person, but they do represent a piece of the population, don't they?
Sadly, yes.
Anyway, did you really want me to speak? Because these students know I can keep going. But
we just wanted you on tape.
I am heartfelt that you came here. My dean is here. She said you have to see this man. He speaks the truth, and it's more valuable than anything you'll hear in your entire week. So please come, and I'm here. But I am going to. I have 27 people waiting for me, and I want to tell them that I come with all. I come with good wishes and good spirit from you.
And let's talk one day.
All right, we can. Oh, really?
Yeah, you have more to say. So let's go all the way to the back, you know. Thank you. Let's go all the way to the back, two rows. Who has something brilliant to say? Okay, semi-brilliant.
What can we do to help?
So I gave you a simple example. You have the United States Senator from Maine saying no to the Secretary of Education. And she said no because the people of Maine spoke up. Now the truth is United States senators can be influenced by other people. And I don't think she has higher ambitions. I don't think, because she's not a popular Republican. So I don't think she wants to be vice president. She might want to, but it ain't gonna happen. Every place I go, I ask people to adopt Portman of Ohio. He came so close to voting no. Mr. Trump is going to wear the nerves of the Republicans out, particularly in the Senate. And I think a year from now, they will be more willing not to do evil things. And I also think, now by the way, Americans are not good at this. French, Germans, they all have their state rep on speed dial. And you know, you hear from them every month. In the United States, about 92% of people have never communicated with their own United States senator. Now, I always like to share this with people. I used to be chief of staff to a congressman. And he had a rule. One person calls, writes, they're probably a nut, they don't have anything else to do. Two people, did you pay attention to that second caller? Same issue. Third person, I want to know about it. You listening? It takes very little to interest a member of Congress. And when 100 people speak up, they get nervous. So I urge it. I urge it. There are US senators, Republicans, that will get nervous and or who are decent. Remember, since we're in an educational setting, Betsy, the new Secretary of Education's number one goal is to destroy public schools. That is her goal. Now, all kinds of people talk about charters all the time. Something like 51% of black people are in favor of charters. Totally in favor of charters. I don't see anything wrong with being in favor of charters. It's the new thing. In Rhode Island, we have 442 elementary schools and 11 charter schools. Did you hear that? Kids can't go to charter schools. They don't exist. So you're going to destroy the public school system for something that doesn't exist? And you ready for this language, this dialogue we have? That is absurd. Charter schools are so much better than public schools, and everybody knows it. Now that's the official thought in almost everybody's mind. Oh, public schools are awful. Garbage. In Rhode Island, the public schools in Central Falls, Pawtucket, and Providence are awful. In Bristol, Warren, Cranston, Warwick, Lincoln, they're so much better than the charter schools. Charter schools that don't have gyms, don't have swimming pools, don't have libraries, don't have anything except lack of violence, which is a really great thing to have. But these charter schools, of the 20 of them, one, two of them are good, five, six of them are okay, and 10 of them are lousy. And all they keep saying is, the public schools are awful. I will bet you 350 Providence, Rhode Island, not Providence, Rhode Island, Rhode Island public schools are here, and charters are here. You've been tricked. We're going to save the little black children in Detroit by putting them in charter schools. And what they have done, she almost got indicted for it. They have closed 50% of the public schools and they are a mess. That's what she wants to do to America. So, long answer to you. Every time something comes up you don't like, find yourself a US senator. Okay, the next three or four rows. What do you see? This is participatory. This is like, you know. Now, if I had on a purple shirt that cool, I'd be speaking up.
You know, those people are not gonna wait.
Who's next? Yes, sir.
The question you raised when you went around asking people, "What are you angry about?"
Yes.
I think that's really key, because it seems like people don't know what they're angry about. What do you think they're angry about?
Nothing. I think...
So they don't know what they're
angry about. So Hillary Clinton got in trouble for, you know, all these people in the basket. I think a majority of white people in America are racist. But you hear what I said, it's a majority. And I don't know if that's 51% or 61%. I don't know what it is, but it's high. And the reason I know what I'm talking about is Yale does the survey study every year, and it's quantitative, and white folks say the most unbelievable things. Now, I told you I believe the majority of white people are racist. Now, I did not tell you they got out of bed and formulated it and worked on being a racist. I didn't tell you that. I didn't tell you it's informed at all. Now, let me be very careful, because I like to be popular. You know, I want to be invited back again. You ready? So I get a membership. Now, I'm sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. I go to the Boston Athenaeum. I go up to the desk. And I have my new membership in my hand. I've never been there before. And I go up to the desk, and the man behind the counter says, non-members, he's got a nasty tone, can't leave the first floor. The other four floors are for members only. And then he turns his back on me. And I say, excuse me, and I show him my membership. It's a gold-carded membership. It costs $7,000. I didn't pay for it. I have a kind of in-law by marriage who lives in California. His mother gave the Athenaeum $1 million, and they gave all seven children a lifetime membership. And he gave me his. And they transferred it in very formal way. You should see it. It looks like a presidential whatever. And they think I have some money, is what they think. So I show it to him, and he looks at it, and he goes, wow, you're that kind of member? Now, I step aside, I'm hanging up my coat, white woman walks up and he says, are you a member? That's what he says to her. Now, a friend of mine who's a shrink said he was so nice to her because he'd been so nasty to me, so he's making up. Other friend of mine, shrink at the table, says, nope, he's a racist. I have that in my life every day. I'm sorry, I hate exaggeration. That happens to me every other day in my life. I'm a black man, and people do that. Now, would you like to have some fun? The person doing that to me was a black man. The man at the counter, being nasty in a prestigious place, was a black man. It's in the culture. Black people are poor, they're low class, they couldn't possibly be a member, and it's in the brain. And the majority of white folks believe it, and a lot of black folks believe it. They really do. So all my life, I dress a little better, I walk a little taller, because I want less mistreatment. So no, people are angry about nothing. The economy goes to the brink of collapse under Mr. Bush. Mr. Obama brings it back. People have a raise for the first time in 15 years, everything's going this way, unemployment, everything. They give him almost no credit, but everybody has to know. I almost lost my house, and now I'm okay. I'm not dancing in the streets, but I'm okay. So, no, they're lying. A black man should not have occupied that office, sat in the Oval Office. That job belongs to a white man. A lot of people believe it. Yes, sir.
So when you say, and I agree, that they don't know what they're angry about,
yes.
It's something in the culture, and it's in the brain, as
yes.
You said. That requires some really deep change to get it out of the brain. I mean, I see that as a real problem.
Yeah,
it's in the culture.
At Brown University, children of the rich and the wealthy have a pretty good mindset. Now, I didn't tell you they're doing anything good in the world, but they're not half as bad as their parents and not one-fifth as bad as their grandparents. It is possible. An awful lot of upper-class white kids have come around on gay rights, on transgender issues, on race. They really have. So it is possible. And I look all the time, where did that come from? And my theory, I want to write something about it, is hate is a heavy burden. And if you can avoid it and you have any sense, you do. It really must be awful being frightened of people, of hating people, of sitting there watching basketball game calling people the N-word. It really must weigh on your soul. And I think a whole bunch of 19-year-olds have found the way around it. Now, I think for everybody older than 19, you got a problem. And I tell people all the time, I teach diversity workshops, real ones, with police and fire, and let me tell you. And half the people are frightened to say or do anything. There you are playing cards with your friends, and one of them starts. There's six of them and one of you. What are you supposed to do? I say, lean back in the chair, get a glass of water or beer, whatever you're drinking, and kind of drink it, and then say, in the lowest tone, in the most gingerly way, I don't really like that. And then go on back to what you're doing. Nobody has ever said that to them. Ever. And so they think you believe what they believe and that that's okay. And if you were begin to speak up every single time, I think society would change. Now, I'm not Pollyanna. There are a whole bunch of 60-year-olds. They ain't going to change. They're just not going to do it. But a lot of people change because they want to keep their job, because somebody's going to sue them. There are reasons people change. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted, well, first of all, I think that having a woman president after a black president just killed everything. But some of the white privilege stuff, I think until things kind of come out in the public, I had an incident like 10 years ago. My mother was dying. I was trying to get there before she died. I was pouring down tears, you know, driving fast. I got pulled over. It didn't occur to me at all then because I jumped out of the car. I said to the police officer, I've got to go. My mom's dying. I've got to get there. He was very rude to me. You know, I got back in the car, and that had always bothered me. And it wasn't until all of this stuff has come up lately of, you know, that's kind of filtered into the public consciousness, not, you know, just like there was the Republican black congressman who said, I get stopped all the time by police. But, you know, until we've started having these incidents kind of bubble up in the national consciousness, it never occurred to me that that was a white privilege moment. You know, I was mad at that guy for being such a jerk. He barked at me to get back in the car. He took his time coming over. You know, I managed to get home 20 minutes before my mom died. But I've always been angry for that. And I thought, you know, when I started speaking up about it several years ago, I was like, you know, if I had not been a white woman, I could have been dead. Like, that never even occurred to me until recently. And I think some of that is, you know, I mentioned that to people, and I can see just a shutdown of, like, I don't want to think, like, it's not a comfortable thought that that I was able to go all those years, because this was like 12 years ago, not even occurring to me that, like, oh, thank God I didn't get killed. No parent ever gave me the talk about, like, if a police officer stops you, I've got to be careful. Like, that has never been something. So I think part of it, too, is, you know, the biased media. I think that's one reason that it's the media is being gone after, because if things are out there in the public so that people are more aware of what the, you know, what Joyce had said about walking in, you know, the footsteps of someone else and seeing what is actually out there, I think younger people get that more easily. But I am very concerned about this whole shutdown of the media.
You mean attack on the media?
Well, yeah. Well, the desired shutdown. Yeah. I mean, I think the latest thing was, if you're not going to support us, we're shutting you down kind of sentiment.
So, can I tell you, I believe people should speak up every day, all the time. If there's an incident of any kind, they should speak up. And your kind of experience, any chance you get to tell it, you should tell it. I told you earlier, I think the majority of white folks are racist, but I don't think they're constitutionally racist. I think Americans believe things that are just absurd. And where they get it from, You can't figure it out, but it's in the brain. And it's in the brain. So I think we can work on people. I think we can just say to them, that's not true. It's not true. Yes, sir.
I just want to know, why don't you think there's a standard procedure for rules of engagement when you stop somebody in a car?
You mean policemen?
Policemen.
There are standard rules of engagement. They lean to the benefit of the police officer and not to the benefit of the average citizen. And then, let's say the police officer's frightened of you. A black man in Minnesota tells the police officer he has a gun because that's what he's supposed to do. When you have a gun in the car, you're supposed to alert the police officer. The police officer kills him because he has a gun. You listening? He followed the rules. I don't think rules can be followed unless somebody enforces them, other than the police officer. So there are all kinds of rules. You ready? Let me take you to Detroit for a little bit. So 7 years ago, my mother, I go home for Christmas. We're going to Christmas Eve service. And the whole family piles in the big van. My mother gets out of her car and says, Ray, let's spend some quality time together, just you and me. I'm home for the holiday. And it's a half hour to church. So my mother's driving along, and she slides through a red light. And I don't say anything. My mother's just had her 80th birthday, and I'm thinking, uh-oh. And then she slides through another one. Now slide, I mean, she drops from 25 to 7, and then she goes through. And I say, Mom, you're running red lights. And she says, I have permission. Now you're laughing because you don't live in Detroit. The Detroit City Council passed an informal ordinance. Any woman driving after 6 p.m. is free to go through red lights as long as they're not going to cause an accident. Why? 37 carjacks in the year before. You stop at the light, the little criminal comes out with the and breaks your window and takes your car or robs you. 37 of them. So you either can have better policing and hang around at the light and arrest people standing there with a crowbar, or you can let people not stop. So we have all kinds of rules to deal with things. And who do they favor? Now that's very weird to have that, because that favors basically women who are going to get in trouble for being out in public at night. Almost all laws favor the boss, favor the cops. I sat in the Rhode Island General Assembly, and I voted no more than anybody. The first reason I vote no is because this law shall become law upon the signature of the governor. The governor's going to sign all these bills in the next 7 days. Might sign this one tomorrow. And you own a little store and you got to do this new tax thing and you don't get any notice and you're in violation and you got to do this and you got to do that. I vote no. I don't care how good it is. Procedure, process, fairness. If Donald Trump was right about the borders, which he isn't, he's wrong for implementing something without even telling people how it's going to work. I mean, he's really wrong because he didn't talk to the people who were supposed to make it work. He's just wrong, 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 and unconstitutional, and bad on religion, but forget all that. You need a fair process all the time. This is the new law. It is February 8th, and it will take effect on April 15th. Go get your house in order. So I just vote no, if it took effect immediately. Now I'm telling you this because take the police officer. They are worried about their safety. You can almost talk to any police officer you want, and they will tell you, I do it all the time, this is my hobby, talking to police officers. They will tell you, I'm going home tonight. The criminal, I'm going to whatever. And I say, oh, I agree with you. Somebody has a knife and they come at you, the law is shoot. And I'm not really big on killing folks, but the truth is you have a right. And they have a gun, and the law is you're not supposed to shoot anybody unless you shoot to kill. So if you shoot them, you're shooting to kill. And I'm in favor of that. They pull a gun on you, you have a right and an obligation to yourself and your family. Go home tonight. I believe in it.
What about the guy that said
you're no, free? But the 12-year-old kid in the park with the plastic gun with the red top on it, you had an obligation to wait 2 seconds. They shot the kid 6 seconds after they arrived, and the gun's pointing down. And nobody is complaining. Now, is that fear and racism or just fear? Doesn't matter. It's a crime. The cop just murdered a kid. So I've been trying to get credit. You can spread this. This is my theory. Probably 99% of black folks who get killed by cops would be alive if the cop gave them 7 seconds. The cop gives white folks 7 seconds. And they give certain white folks 10 minutes. The woman in Texas pointing the gun at the cops and they never shot her. Never. And legally they're supposed to. You point a gun at a cop, you're supposed to go to heaven or hell. Immediately. So you'll see case after case, the white kid having a gun and they don't shoot him. Now, your moral core says that's good, but the truth is it should apply to everybody. So here's my favorite. You ready? Providence, Rhode Island. Off-duty police officer. He's in a restaurant and at night, and there's a little whatever in the parking lot and the light, and 2 police officers show up. And he runs out, and he takes his coat and opens it. This is Cornell Jr. He opens it to show his gun and says, "I am." 30 people heard him say, "I am." And they blow his head off before he comes to the third word. I would bet $10,000. He was going to say, "I am an off-duty police officer." He needed 4 seconds. He didn't touch the gun. He knew better. And he made a mistake of showing a gun to 2 uptight police officers, and they murdered him. That's America. 88% of all black police officers88% of all police officers shot by other police officers are black. They don't see them as police officers. They are frightened of black people. And on and on and on. And it's all irrational. The average white person who has a gun has 3.5. The average black person with a gun has 1 1/4. You ought to be worried about white men in Burrowville. That's what you ought to be worried about if you were a cop. But race gets in the way. It really does. I hope I answered you. When a cop does something bad, they need to be punished like anybody else. And that's hard to do because juries let them go, prosecutors let them go, and in most of these cases you see cold-blooded murder. And if they shot a white person, they'd be on their way to the prison. Yes?
Can I just say something? The point of the question was just a standard procedure. So regardless if the guy in Michigan had the gun, we're seeing over and over and over again the standard procedure gone wrong. So it's not just because I'm black and I got a hat on and a sweatshirt and I'm here to get education, just like everybody else. But I could be looked at as anything. I really don't care. But the point is that if this lady right here is getting pulled over, I want the same standard procedure.
And we're in 100% agreement.
If there's not, if there's no undermine in that, and I can see on the news, not even just other guys getting shot and killed, just put on the news, and you will see standard procedure failing.
You and I are 100% in agreement. What are you talking about?
But you can't bring up a guy in Michigan waving the gun when you got a 12-year-old kid getting shot. You got a bigger guy screaming he can't breathe, and he's still getting choked out. These are things that are
Wait a second. I didn't talk about any black person waving a gun.
You did.
There are about 33 of these cases that have come to public attention. And in all 33, the person didn't do anything that warranted that kind of response. In all 33, what you're saying is true. Okay? Now we got 100 with some gang person in Chicago that's more complicated, whereas even if they were white, they probably wouldn't have been killed. But nobody's going to side with them because of their background. But in all the cases you're talking about, the cops are rogues. And in only two of them does it look like they're going to jail. So cops can do anything they want.
I think it was that particular case that he was a legal gun holder.
He didn't wave the gun. He didn't show the gun.
It was just—it was legal, and what they are following procedure. You have to say if you have a gun, he legally owned a gun. If it was a white person,
that's murder. Wait! I'm pushing back hard against both of you. That was one of the most blatant murder cases ever.
He didn't realize what that story was.
Oh, the gun never was shown. He just announced he had it.
So he was following procedure. The police officer did not follow
the procedure. The black man was following procedure, and he got him killed.
Right.
And that's your trouble, that even when you do the right things, it's liable to backfire on you. You know, you and I are not going to have a controversial conversation, but can I tell you something?
Yes, that's what
people have biases. And I have two nephews, grandnephews. Isn't that cool? We made that up. I don't know if there's such a thing. But I have a 7 and a 9-year-old, my brother's grandchildren. And they asked me for hoodies for Christmas. And I bought them yellow hoodies. Yellow. The same color yellow, green, that is being worn behind me there. Okay? Now, why did I buy them light yellow hoodies? Because half the world thinks that black men in dark hoodies are bad people. And you wouldn't imagine somebody would do something to a 7 or 9-year-old for wearing a hoodie. But I cannot imagine what evil can come out of the minds of bad people. So I bought them light hoodies. It shouldn't have to be that way. Yesterday in Attleboro at your, at Bristol, I gave one of my favorite stories. In my diversity workshops, I show a photo of 7 women wearing burqas. It's from the back. And I asked, when I first started this 20 years ago, I asked the police to fire the college people in the room, hospital people, do you think women should be able to wear burqas in America? And I'd have 40 people in the room, and I have one yes, you know, little half a yes, I used to call them. And 39's, no, this is America. You should get with the program. And I let them talk for 5 minutes. And then I take the photo. It's my favorite thing. I take the photo, and I turn it around. And I put it over the closest person. I say, can you read this? And they read it. Read it loud. 7 Roman Catholic nuns at Jackie and John Kennedy's wedding in Newport, Rhode Island. Nuns used to wear burqas, wool, tight. They used to faint in the summer. No one could see their hair but God. Burqas. And I would say to the people present, whatever you don't like, your mother and your grandmother, your aunt, one of these nuns, did the exact same thing. Exact. Then I talk about hoodies. 80% of all hoodies are sold to white people. You know, cool white kids with their hoodies. Everybody's wearing a hoodie. Everybody's wearing a hoodie. It shouldn't be a sin, and it's not a reason for a negative reaction. People dream things up. So that's the other thing I tell people. Whatever you think you don't like, think about it a little bit, and you will find out that your family did it too. Last little favorite thing. We have how many more minutes? So my last little favorite thing is people are always complaining that something's in Spanish. Or, you know, hey, why do we have to put that in Spanish? Well, this is America. Well, first I say, well, third of America used to be Spain and Mexico, so first, and they were here first. But anyway, never mind all that. When I was a kid and lived in Detroit, in our Lithuanian, Latvian, Estonian, Greek neighborhood, you go in the store and there was a sign in Greek. I never could do much with Greek, but there it was. Because two-thirds of the white people, particularly of a certain age, didn't speak English. You ready? They didn't speak English. So this is people's grandmother that we're talking about, who is busy complaining about Spanish in their own lifetime. You listening? Bias is stupid, it's rude, it's bad, it's ignorant, and 9 out of 10, you're hurting yourself. 9 out of 10. 1 out of 10, hey, your bigotry got you someplace. But normally you're creating a bad society. This is the greatest country in the world because it moves forward. Thank you for letting me come.